everybody, and welcome back to Cantripped. My name is Connor, I use he, their pronouns, and today I am going to be our host and keeper for a very supernatural Halloween episode of Cantripped. And here is my party.
Hello, I'm Art. My pronouns are they, them, and I'm playing Casey Cardwell, whose pronouns are he, they. Or, no, he, him. That's a guy. It's a man.
Hi, I'm Beck. My pronouns are she, they, and I'm going to be playing Rosie Deacon, and her pronouns are she, her. I'm also just a girl. We got a he, him, and a she, her. We're on a great start.
Howdy, folks. It's the Beetle Bard. You guys can call me Beetle. My pronouns are they, them, and my character is mostly known as Eugene and uses all pronouns.
Hi, I'm Jamie. My pronouns are they, them. I'm playing Sterling Ayers, who uses they, them pronouns.
We got one of every flavor. We got a he, him, we got a she, her, we got a they, them, and we got an all.
Let's go.
So many flavors.
So, as listeners might have guessed by the term keeper at the start of the episode, we are today not going to be playing in D&D or any homebrew system, but Monster of the Week by Michael Sands. For the most part, it is a 2d6 based system focused on narrative storytelling, in which I, as the keeper, do not roll any dice and am reacting purely to what the characters are doing. As a heads up, because this is a horror Halloween episode, there are some trigger warnings for the episode from here on out. Particularly, there are trigger warnings for injury, blood, and gore, death, decay, and reanimation, body horror and transformation, claustrophobia, uncanniness and the uncanny valley, bugs and insects, and heavy religious themes and religious horror. I feel like I just read a lot of trigger warnings at the start, and I apologize.
No, it just means there's going to be some flavor this time around.
Yeah, some flavor.
It is Halloween.
It is Halloween.
Exactly. This is the Halloween. This is our first Halloween special.
It is.
Yippee!
And so, if we are ready to get started with this particular Halloween special, I would like to welcome you all to the year 1864. In the deserts of New Mexico, in the empty orange plains where the hard steel winding railroads fear to creep, and the wind drags screams like tumbleweeds through the warm, desolate wilds, this is a town. A town built on a drying up well above a drying up mine nestled between the bluffs. A place where the residents are as tough and hard-baked as the earth beneath their feet and as dry as the dust in the desert air. Welcome to the town of Umber Hollow, a mining town eternally teetering on the verge of becoming a ghost town and being pushed closer every day. A town in which something strange has begun and in which, 3 weeks ago, the first life was claimed by something unknown. A lonely priest, desperate to hold on to normality as his home changes and transforms into something darker, has called for aid in fending off the horrors that lie waiting 6 feet under.
Woo!
Paint me a picture with your words, Connor.
Paint me a picture.
Mr. Wordsmith.
So as we start weaving through the towering orange bluffs of the New Mexico desert, two figures approach on horseback. The nearest town with railway access sits a day's ride to the east in the Oklahoma Territory. And nearing the end of their journey, Eugene Garza and Sterling Ayers approach the small town of Umber Hollow. Jamie and Beetle, would you like to give us a quick introduction and description of your characters, please?
So Eugene looks like, has like tan skin, black hair with like a little undercut underneath, and then some like white pieces kind of framing the sides of their face and a little bit in the front of where their bangs are. They have a little beauty mark underneath their left eye, like hazel colored eyes, like brown, but like in the middle it's almost like a little green. But they have the biggest eyes, like if I can reference another cantrip, like big ol' Kieran eyes. Big ol' eyes. which is a little off-putting, and is wearing kind of like an open vest, a shirt that's really low buttoned, the fringes on the vest, and some of those, it's not assless chaps, I think they're just chaps.
Regular chaps. They do not have to be assless. It's not a
they do. Legally, yes, they do. This is a cowboy game, goddammit.
Real cowboys show ass.
Tagline of the one shot. Sorry, Connor, move over. Real cowboys show ass.
I want that as a t-shirt. Real cowboys show ass.
To just round it all off, rolled up like sleeves and then nice suspenders. And that's all.
Dapper.
Do we want to reveal our playbooks just yet, or would we like to keep those for later when things start kicking off a bit more?
Can it be later? Can we reveal it?
We can reveal later, absolutely.
Okay. Are they on horseback? Because I think
so. Yes.
Yeah! Do you want to describe your horse, Beetle? Because I know I do.
You have to describe your horse first, because I didn't consider what horse
you
look.
You did not consider your horse look? I don't have a detailed horse description of Sterling's horse, but you'll never guess what color it is. It's a silver horse. Like a really pretty kind of gray dappled color. And then, because I feel like the horse attracts the eye before the rider does. The Sterling is atop this horse, and they have gray hair that's kind of like obviously cut themselves, really choppy layers. Something that would resemble a modern day wolf cut, but not intentionally, and it kind of falls over their eyes and their face a little. And their eyes are really deep sunken into their face a little, but if you get close enough to spot them, they are a fun kind of yellow greenish that's kind of startling. They wear like a bandana pulled up over the rest of their face most of the time, but are dressed in kind of layers of leather, a very long black leather coat and gloves, and kind of covered head to toe, cowboy hat pulled low.
Should I soft launch my horse?
Soft launch your horse.
My horse is just so okay. It's not a mule. There's something there's just something about the way that it is, you know? It looks a little silly, a little goofy. It has like really oddly well taken care of mane, and there's like little braids in it that have like a bone kind of braided into it, or like a seashell, or just like odd little baubles and trinkets braided into this like horse's mane.
Oh, I'm delighted.
And it's kind of like a tannish gray with like a little white like, not like a racing stripe, but like down the face, it has like, not in the shape of a cross, because I don't want to go too heavy handed with the imagery, mm-hmm. but like,
not yet.
That, that like shape. And then like the most off putting blue eyes.
So, approximately 2 weeks ago, Eugene received a letter from an old acquaintance in their hometown of Umber Hollow. The resident priest, Father Arthur Matthews, called you for aid after the beginnings of something strange. People starting to go missing, people falling ill, and a strange sway overtaking the small population. How long ago do you think that Eugene left Umber Hollow, Beetle?
So Eugene left when they were like 18, and I would think that they're either like 21, 22 kind of age. I don't think that they actually know, but that's the mm-hmm. age, is like the age range.
Mm-hmm. You suddenly remember the residents of Umber Hollow being a little strange even without something hanging over them. There was never too many residents about 20, 30 years ago, before you were born. The gold that fueled the town's economy started to dry up, and people started to move away. The only people who were really invested enough to stick around were people who really had stakes in the town. I feel like it was fairly unusual for anyone to reach out to you in this manner, but especially Father Matthews. As you approach the town, you can see standing on the edge of a familiar saloon, leaning on the railings with a Bible in his hands. A different man. Father Matthews was old. Even when you knew him, there was more gray than black in his salt and pepper beard, and he was slow to move about the town. But the young man standing on the porch of the saloon, looking out as two new riders approach, is young with messy, mousy brown hair and a cold look in his sunken eyes. He folds up the pages of his Bible, his finger still between the covers to mark his pages. And he waits for these two new riders to approach.
I think Eugene kind of like doesn't like narrow their eyes, but like definitely squint a little. And this is like someone I don't recognize at all.
No, you have never seen this person, as far as you know. But they seem to be expecting you. They step out from around a post and down the couple of steps. Well, it's not entirely unusual that we get new folks here in Umber Hollow these days, but I feel like you might be the person I was told to watch out for.
Might I inquire who you might be?
Sort of gives a small bow, somewhere between a bow and an incline of the head. It's just stiff enough to look awkward. Of course, my name is Reverend Harvey Montague. I am the assistant at the local parish. My mentor, let's say, informed me of your arrival. I'm ashamed to say that we would have liked you here earlier. And as he's saying this, from inside the Solid Mercury Saloon steps one of the owners. Beck, would you like to introduce your character?
Yeah, sure. So, thank God you had a saloon name. I need you guys to know I was frantically Google searching saloon names 2 seconds ago.
Yeah, saloon name is the Solid Mercury Saloon.
Cool. I writes that down. But yeah, my character is Primrose Deacon, but if you call her Primrose, she will fucking deck you, so just keep that in mind. Everybody calls her Rosie. She's got kind of long-ish brown hair that's like always a little bit tangled. She keeps it up, but not as like a fashion statement thing. It's definitely a just get this shit out of my face, please, God, sort of updo situation. And I'm realizing now I have given her the fanfiction messy bun and I'm going to die. she's very, very much not your like Southern Belle type. She is, I am here, I am angry, and I don't like that I'm here. kind of energy, but yeah.
And as you step out, you catch the end of the Reverend's statement as he looks up at Eugene, casting an intrigued glance to Sterling. He says, I regret to inform you that Father Matthews passed away last night. Which is not only news to you, Eugene, but also news to Rosie.
Father Matthews passed away?
I think he sort of turns around and again does that sort of stiff inclined bow. I apologize. I would appreciate if this doesn't get around too many people. It's a recent development, I believe. Very unfortunate turn his circumstances.
If you want that on the down low, maybe don't start spilling that information to strangers outside the saloon.
Strangers?
Her face changes when she looks up and she looks at you. I think I go through like 7 different emotions in like the course of 30 seconds.
Rosie.
Oh, my fucking God. Yuji, is that you?
Yeah. At this point, Eugene got down off the horse and is walking their horse.
Cool. Then can I walk up and slap you?
Go for it.
Sterling chuckles.
Dang!
Wow, no friendship in this room. I'm gonna walk up and slap you.
Eugene is gonna touch the cheek that you slapped and blink twice and look back up at you and says, "Well, you look good after all this time."
Yeah, I do. And I'm gonna... Can I turn around and storm back into the saloon, please?
Sure.
Cool.
Yeah, you're allowed to do whatever you want. Yeah,
I don't want to, throw off your plans, Connor.
No,
but I also... Yeah.
My plan was put you all in front of the saloon. I don't know.
Cool. Yeah.
I think that Reverend Montague is sort of watching this interaction and goes, I'm glad to see that I made the correct assumption and you're being the person that I was told to watch out for. The Lord does tend to guide me in such ways as small inklings into the truth. And you might be... And he looks up at Sterling.
Sterling, what exactly are we here for? In more detail?
I assumed that the two of you would have more detail.
Well, you know what they say about assuming.
He gets such a... Cruel is the wrong word, but...
I'm scared.
Smug?
Sort of smug. I suppose anger. Just a flash of disgruntled upset at this person who he has been waiting for treating him in such a manner. But he gives a little smile. And nods as well. Yes. I am sorry, Eugene, was it that your timing was as poor as it is, but I am sure that if you would like to find out why you were sent for, as I certainly would, you could speak to, and before he can finish, a voice calls out to him from across the town square. You sure as hell better not be f***ing with the new people in town already, Montague. And striding as quickly as she can across town center is who you would have known formerly, Eugene, as Deputy Lucia, but who is now Sheriff Barrow Cunningham of Umbra Hollow, pulling her hat off her head as she storms towards the Reverend. And sort of tailing behind is the new deputy. Art, would you like to introduce your character?
Oh my god, I go here. Casey Cardwell is a fairly tall, 6 feet, 6'1" or two. Dark black hair that's a little bit shaggy, a little scraggly, could probably use with a cut, but it's kind of almost tasteful. Has a cowboy hat on, a pair of whatever variation of sunglasses that existed.
He invented sunglasses.
We can say you have sunglasses. We'll say.
Pretty simple button-down shirt that's mostly unbuttoned. A large, dark overcoat of leather. Chaps, spurs clinking as he walks. You can't really see his eyes. He's probably flicking out a cigarette as he's following behind her, and he is step for step at her heel, almost like a shadow.
As the group of you are sort of witnessing this confrontation between the priest and the sheriff, Sheriff Barrow Cunningham sort of steps between Eugene and Reverend Montague and sort of turns to you and says, I am so sorry for the way that he's acting. Our new resident doesn't quite know how to greet people here, and halfway through her sentence, registers and recognizes Eugene in much the same way that Rosie did, that sort of moment's hesitation before piecing the dots together. Ms. Garza, well, I'll be damned. What brings you here, exactly? I thought that after the whole situation, things were... Sort of like glances back at the saloon and like peering around the door and things. As I said, I apologize for Al.
Are you gonna hit them too?
Do I need to?
I don't know. I was just curious. Does anybody here like you, Eugene?
Well, I don't think that just because Rosie slapped me, I don't think that means she doesn't like me. I don't think.
Well, I mean, that's, you know what? Sure, carry on. Sure, yeah, let's go with that.
I can't say there's any particular bad blood between us. It's just surprising to see you back in town. Is there anything I can help you with, exactly? It's sort of glancing over her shoulder to glare at Reverend Montague again.
I think that Eugene's gonna, like, put his, like, arm on, like, her shoulder and just be like, there's no need. No, I was just sent for by Father Matthews. And, well, there are things that he wanted me to see to. It's unfortunate to hear of his passing, but God always has a plan. So, it must be important that I'm here at this moment.
A sort of shadow falls across her face as you're saying this. Yes, I've been hearing a lot recently about God's plan from a few varying sources, and again, sort of turns back to glare at Montague, and then, at the mention of his passing, looks over to Casey and sort of shares a quiet look before leaning in a little closer and going, what exactly did you hear about Father Matthew's passing?
I reckon just enough.
Well, that fills me with confidence. Rosie, you still lingering by the doorway there?
There's a pause, and then a, what's it to ya?
He sort of like lifts, without even turning around, like lifts up a hand and does a little like, come here the gesture over the shoulder, but come on. All right. Everybody
look,
here.
It ain't my fault.
You're not in trouble, Rosie. I just
ain't my fault. Reverend over here doesn't know how to whisper.
No, I know it's not, and trust me, it is rather a situation I would not be dealing with. Casey, did you lock up the station before we left?
I think Casey at this point has like slinked away, not that far, but just is like in a chair, very leisurely existing. She's got this.
With his sunglasses.
With his sunglasses, new cigarette he's done got. Just him. Lounging. And probably looks up and is like, you know I did.
All right. Everybody here, except for you, she turns to face the Reverend again.
Everyone with this guy.
He's going to come with me right now.
Sheriff, I'm in the middle of a shift. I can't just...
That's wonderful, Rosie. So am I.
Almost mad.
I think she like it's if it's a saloon door, like it's not a full door, right?
It's up to you. It's your saloon or your family saloon.
Sure. It's not a full door. She'll like turn around and go, "Mama!"
Yeah.
I got to go down to the sheriff wants me to go down to the station.
What'd you do?
Nothing. Listen to a preacher.
Yeah, that'll happen. All right.
I was telling you about them creatures. You keep listening to them. All
right, cool. I'm good.
Yeah, I think that there's like some brief conversation of being like, okay, as long as you're not like in trouble or anything, sure, like go ahead. I think like it's a very small town. I think that for most of the time that, especially the two of you have grown up in the town, there really wasn't a lot of people, like even the sheriff, and as I said, until you know, recently, for most of your lives, you probably would have known her as the deputy. is on fairly close terms with everyone, knows everyone by name, knows the families and people's parents and grandparents. It's not entirely unusual to maybe be tapped on the shoulder to help, you know, just move cabinets or move something like that. And so with this small group, I think that Sheriff Lucia maybe lets her gaze linger on Sterling before turning back to Eugene as, they with you?
Yeah.
All right, sure. Has there enough people heard about this? All right. And she leads you sort of across town. Most of the buildings, much like the saloon, are quite old, very worn down, this dying, dusty-colored wood with the paint peeling away. The town was fairly quick to be put up and had very much an air of new and limited wealth in the early 1800s when it really first started booming as a gold mining town. And in the decades since, hasn't really been upkept all too well as money has slowly trickled away. And the sheriff takes you to a building that you would recognize as Dr. Darcy's, the local physician, but not to the front door, to a door around the back. And she sort of, even without knocking, pushes it open and yells in, "Patrick, you in at the moment?" And there's some shuffling from a different room, but the first person you see is certainly not Dr. Patrick Darcy, but a young woman, probably about your age. You guys probably even would have been in the local school together. Angela Darcy, his daughter and assistant, steps out in an apron with a perhaps concerning amount of blood across the front of it. I'm sorry, he's busy. Sheriff, can I help you? You're it? I'm sorry? Hi. What exactly is going on?
Is there a problem? You're covered in blood.
Oh, yeah, that's, my job now. Sorta.
Oh. Amazing how much you miss when you disappear, ain't it?
Yeah.
Everything's changed a lot more than I thought it was gonna.
She's not looking at you. She's not looking at you, by the way.
Like, I need to state that Uriel / Eugene is like not taking any of like receiving it, but it's like, yeah, you're so right. Like you're so right. You're always right. Like everything that's been said to them.
Oh no, he's a himbo.
It's not even like they're just silly goofy like that, you know?
Yeah, I guess since you left, Andrew Milton, our undertaker, sort of packed up and moved his bags out maybe a year or two ago, and, Pa kind of took over that role, and, I mean, he's still got to practice, so, I'm the town undertaker now, in a way.
Hmm.
Sheriff, deputy, is this about the issue that we wanted to be kept quiet? I think she's looking at Casey. I think that looking directly at the sheriff is a little bit too intimidating.
Poor girl! Hey,
what's going on? Yes, I also don't think she's entirely comfortable looking at Casey, because I think that Casey is still, to many people in the town, despite having been there for a little while, somewhat of a new and off-putting presence, but
oh yeah,
definitely feels like she'll get in less trouble if she oversteps with the deputy.
Yeah, for sure. I think he nods that it is.
Right. Just close the door on your way in. And she sort of leads you all a little bit further into an adjacent room. And it's not exactly like a cold locker, because this is the 1860s, but there is this sort of a handful of long wooden drawers, the top of which has some various equipment over it, and she reaches in and pulls out one of these long sliding drawers on which you can see the shape of a body laid out.
Okay, now hold on. I don't need to see a corpse today. What's this about? If he's dead, yeah, that sucks, but like, I don't need to see it, you know? I can just see the coffin, and that's fine. I don't do open casket type shit.
There's not going to be an open casket for Father Matthews, Rosie. Father Matthews was found murdered at 2 a.m. this morning on the doors of the church.
Mm. Well, now we're getting somewhere.
I say murdered in a hesitant tone because as if you are not preferring to leave, you will see. She kind of steps down towards the head and gestures for Angela to roll back the sheet that's placed over the body. And as Angela pulls the body back, and even herself, as the mortician looks away a little bit, you see that the entire left side of what would have been Father Matthew's neck and chest has been shredded. It is clawed and ripped. You can see the sinew and even down to the collarbone snapped and broken and ripped away in this jagged and animalistic way with claw marks stretching right across the neck. Reverend Montague found him, claiming it was an animal attack. It would be something I was more willing to believe if it wasn't for the fact that Father Matthews was stabbed through the heart prior to the attack. And I think as she says this, she glances up at Casey and just sort of, with a look that's far more compassionate than a lot of the looks she's been giving until now, just holds your gaze for a minute and judges your reaction. I think that you've definitely heard of the death and you've heard of the murder accusation, but not quite to this extent and haven't seen the full details yet.
I think Sterling's like taken their hat off and gotten all up in the body's business, like investigating it more closely.
Mm-hmm. Are you using any particular moves in this situation or is it just having a look?
That requires me to know moves that I don't
read a bad
know.
Situation.
Yeah, I would like to do that.
Or investigate a mystery. Yeah. Which is the
that
move
one
for investigating.
More accurate.
Yeah, it's more investigating. Read a bad situation was just the first one that popped in my head because I went, this is a bad situation.
This is a bad situation. That's a fair read.
I think in this case, since it's not an active situation, yeah. It's investigate a mystery. Yeah. So you can ask those questions. Yeah.
Okay. Plus sharp. Okay. That's 11.
Holy
shit.
Mm-hmm. You can ask two questions, and there's like a little list. You can ask any of those, or you can kind of go off chart if none of them feel right.
Yeah.
But you get to ask two things.
I don't know if many of these, the given ones, fit the example, except for what happened here.
You can go off book.
I'm trying to use my brain.
So it's like, what are you looking for when you are investigating? What do you want to know?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess what happened here, like, could, more specifically, like, could a person have done this?
The wounds that look more animalistic? No, a regular person could not have done this.
Okay.
The depth of the teeth marks and even at looking at some of it, the size of the jaw marks and the way that it's dug into the flesh are too distended for a human mouth to make. But looking at the wound to the heart, that does look like something. It is distinct from these rough and jagged scratches and bites. It is a clean knife wound through the chest.
Okay. I think Sterling's gonna go, well, if your suspect did it, I don't think he did it alone.
That is what we're worried about. Unfortunately, it sort of widens our field of suspects at any time other than the past 6 to 10 months. We would have had a much easier time ruling people out, but we have sort of had an influx of new people in town of late. It's complicated. Likely more a question for your family, Eugene, than one that I can easily answer.
And why is that?
It pertains at this moment in time to the purchasing of mining rights. Roger Whitmire went missing 6 months ago. He's been presumed dead since, but he was the last of the family. And a few months back, new relatives came in. Started selling off the land to your father. He has had his eye on the Whitmore estate for quite a while.
See. Well, suppose I have to go over there then.
It is my scant knowledge that Father Matthews reached out to you in the weeks before his passing.
Yes, ma'am.
He was piecing something together. A few of us were in on it. Myself, Dr. Darcy, Angela, when required, and at times, Casey. Things have changed in Umber Hollow, Eugene. Not always for the better. Father Matthews is not the first person we've lost, but he is the first body that has turned up on our doorstep. In today's time, most of the town is going to be arriving at the church for mass to find the preacher that has been part of this community for 50 years is dead.
Why can't you just tell him he keeled over? Happens all the time. Heart attack or some shit. Cause that is quite possibly the freakiest shit I have ever seen. And I mean, you could just tell him he's just keeled over, right? I mean,
and if I did, and I let Reverend Montague out there just ease in to the sermon booth.
Oh, okay, I see your point.
I can't confirm if there is blood on his hands, but I sure as hell know that I don't want him trying to lead the people of this town at this point in time. Eugene, I haven't spoken to you in a very long time, and I don't really know who your friend is here, but if you can help move this investigation along, we need to find some kind of answer and stop this from happening.
Well, I can certainly do my best. I'm happy to help.
I would appreciate it. I'll leave you all here with the body for a moment. Your friend Sterling, was it? Seemed to be quite happy with investigating. Deputy, can I speak with you outside for a moment?
Of course. I'll open the door for her.
She steps outside and waits.
Follow suit.
And would you like me to ask everyone else to move into secrets?
Oh my god, get them out of here.
Okay.
I want a secret moment.
The rest of you guys to
timeout corner.
To the timeout corner.
They get hold music.
I think that the second that you're outside and the door is closed,
Casey takes the deepest breath once they're out of there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he'd been holding it that whole time. He doesn't need to breathe, but sometimes he just does it on reflex.
He certainly does not.
And actually inhales and smells when they leave that room.
I think Lucia runs her hands over her face and also just takes a breath and is almost comforted by the fact that you have let out a breath. It's a sign of life that she never expects it from you. She doesn't miss the fact that it's not there usually.
Mm-hmm.
But it's something that she appreciates when there is a sign of life and a sign of humanity.
I think that's why he does it.
She goes, I didn't want to initially show you the body case.
Oh, sure wasn't pretty.
You need to understand. I don't believe that you would. That's not why I wasn't keeping that from you. I just, with everything going on in town, and everything we've been trying to keep quiet, even from you, I couldn't. Do you know what might be doing this?
He, like, takes off his hat and sighs, and he's like,
I don't. Not really. Mm-hmm. It wasn't me.
I know it wasn't you, and I think she maybe, like, reaches over to put a hand on your cheek and kind of turn your face to, like, make sure that you are looking at her in the eye through the sunglasses as she mm-hmm. says this.
I think he often tries not to make direct eye contact with her because he feels his eyes are really unsettling. So when she directs him to do it, he does it on him, like, instinctively.
I mean, it could have been something like me, I guess.
This is information that you would know
mm-hmm.
as a vampire. It's not the kind of bites that you've seen other vampires
mm-hmm.
give. It's not the kind of bite that you have given.
Mm-hmm.
The bites that you're used to seeing are clean and precise fang marks. The mm-hmm. almost cliche, going for the jugular.
This was a mauling.
Quick. This was a mauling.
This was not even like an animal that was hungry when it does a quick and easy and go for the neck. This was satisfaction and like feral in a like
yes
it kind of vibe.
This,
okay.
This attack was savoring what it caused.
Okay, then I think he'll like sigh and say, whatever it is, it's like me or you, not human, that it had fun, it enjoyed that, it didn't need that was more than hunger, that was bloodlust. Now that, whatever did that, and like points back to the door, that's a fucking monster.
I think there's a stoniness that comes over Lucia's face. You're used to seeing the facade that she puts up as sheriff, as this no-nonsense figure of authority. And you're very used to the actual walls that she has put up and the harder nature that she can exhibit, even outside of her position. This is something different. This is a genuine shutting off, a switch being flipped of cold, analytical consideration.
Mm-hmm. What are you thinking?
I'm thinking, Casey, that we have been working to keep you out of the public eye in this town for so long. And if something like this does get out, Reverend Montague knows about this, and he already doesn't like you. If suspicion gets levied at you, if people find out, there's only so much that I can do.
Figure it out. And he pulls back like he's trying to be like this facade, like he isn't fazed by this. And it's something she probably can see through.
Mm-hmm.
Lou, we'll figure it out. We will. Me and this crew, he done gather. You seem to know him. We'll find this. If we can find what it really is, then we'll have nothing to worry about. And if I gotta, I'm good at laying low. I'm good at laying low. I'm a deputy for a reason. Let me try. Let us handle this. The Reverend's got nothing on me. Not if we can beat him to it.
I think we'll see a nods.
Don't go catastrophizing on me just yet. We ain't done loss, Lou. Don't go that far. Come back here.
And she nods, and then she sort of leans in and just presses her forehead against yours and just waits for a minute. I I just want you to be safe.
I will. I'm not going nowheres until I can put a ring on this finger. And he, like, takes her hand and kisses it and does a little bow to really, like, sell it home.
I think that does bring a slight smile, at least a twitch of a lip. Yeah, well, you're going to be waiting a long time for that, deputy.
No, I'm a patient man, Lou.
I can tell.
I got nothing but time. Nothing but time.
Well, unfortunately, in other matters, we are very constricted in time.
There we are. We'll take a look on this. I'll go with this ragtag crew you got here. Good bunch of folks, it seems.
I hope so. Uriel's... I don't know why they split with the Gosses, but if it gets you an in with them, it might be useful. All Matthews would say was that she was part of God's plan. And that's why Eugene was here and in the company of the church. And I don't know what that means. But if at any point in time we sort of needed God's plan, it feels like now isn't going to hurt.
You might be right about that.
I can work on things at the station, try and find records.
Yeah, how about... You know where they found this body. We'll start there.
Yeah.
And go back in, let them know?
Yeah.
We'll start there, and you head back and keep an eye on the town. If we're running about somebody, somebody strong's gonna be here holding the fort.
I'm sure I'm glad I promoted you to deputy. You.
I've got you.
Yeah. Make sure Rosie stays out of trouble.
Oh, I'm not going to make sure of nothing. I think Rosie deserves a little turmoil and trouble, and we'll, like, start heading back in.
I think she just smiles and
let her go shakes loose. Her head. Let and her go crazy.
I think that her hand has still been in yours, and as you kind of step back up through the doorway, she just lets it linger for a second before fingers slip apart. And she follows you back inside, a few steps behind. And we can invite the others back. Are any of you watching the door as they come back in, or are you focused on the body?
I think Sterling probably would be, because they've already checked out the body and is now kind of observing the rest of the space.
You do just notice this very brief lingering contact of hands as Casey steps through the door. And then lets the hand fall back to the side. And Sheriff Lucia steps in.
I was gonna say that I think Uriel is, like, looking at the body. And, like, kind of like, is it, like, is there somewhere where they can, like, grab, not onto the body, but, like, like you know how, like, with the little, the rolly things, how you can, like, lean your hand on, like, the gripper part that, like, you know what I'm
talking about? Grippers. I know, like, the rail, like, yeah, you can, like, lean in closer as you're kind of looking at it a bit more. You can see that Angel sort of hasn't done much with the body apart from just trying to clean that big wound. Like, you can see, looking a bit below his feet, he's still kind of wearing his clothes, he's still dressed apart from the upper garments that have been cut away, and in sort of beneath that sheet that's been rolled away, both his hands actually seem to be clenched, particularly in the right hand is a small chain coming out from his tightly gripped fist.
I
think they're going to, like, open his hand and, like, take the chain, and, like, as they do, a little moth is just gonna, like, fly from just, like, around the room and, like, just kind of land on his hand and, like, sit there.
That's coincidental, I would say, if Eugene believes in that, which may or may not be the case. In the father's palm is a small rosary, a crucifix on a necklace. But beneath that, almost crushed against his palm from this vice-like grip as rigor mortis is starting to set in, is a black witch moth.
Oh, Connor! Oh. Connor! I'm looking at you. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at you, Connor.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, like, Uriel's eyes, like, widen, like, visibly. Like, they're already big and open and got that blink-blink going to them, but, like, widen even more as they, like, look down and, like, pocket the rosary. Or not pocket it, but, like, grab the rosary, but they so gingerly and tenderly, like, pick up the moth to, like, inspect it and look at it. And so they're just gonna look at the moth. Is it, like...
Mm-hmm.
Like, how do I... Does it look like dead, normal dead, or like something messed up happened to this moth, you know?
I think it's normal dead. I think that this moth, it was squished in his palm. it even, actually looking at it closer, I don't think it doesn't look crushed. Like, it's squished, but not crushed, if that makes sense.
Mm.
As if the moth crawled into his enclosed fist.
Mm-hmm.
Almost wiggling in there itself.
Yeah.
And staying in there until it died. It is very much dead. But it wasn't a violent death for this moth. Just a confined one.
They're just looking at nothing. Like, I feel like for most of the time, like, they've been looking around the room, kind of like looking at Rosie. Like, they are just looking at this moth.
And I think the sheriff maybe clears her throat. Says, look, deputy here is gonna scout you all around town, see if you can find anything. If you do need me, I'll be back in the station. I have Father Matthew's diary. I'm trying to look through things, see if I can find much. But at the moment, keeping things on the down low, I can't exactly be interrogating too many people in an official capacity.
Mm.
So, I'm putting my trust in y'all. And if I need to, I swear to God, I will lock every single one of you up.
What the hell did I do? Look,
Rosie, you are a wonderful contributing member of this town. You know so many people. You are a valuable asset, and you were in the wrong place at the wrong time, and I'm very sorry for that, but you are now involved. I hate to break it to you.
Sheriff, I don't do murder trials, okay? I pour drinks for 7 hours a day. I don't know what I'm doing here.
I feel like Casey, like, pipes up. I feel like logistically, since Casey's been in this town for like over a year, has probably come to the tavern, play the saloon a bunch of times, and it's probably like, oh, come on, Rosie, don't you want to have fun?
That ain't fun to me.
Come on, we can go on a little, we're just going to take a little walk around town, see what we see.
I like this guy.
Come on, Rosie.
Your flirting don't work at the bar, and it won't work here either.
I'm not flirting. I just want you to come on out.
Uriel glares.
I'm not flirting.
I think Lucia also glares just a little bit.
I think Casey like pulls his collar. All right. I'm just gonna lie in the mood. All right. I guess.
He like tips his hat further down.
But you know, I think a more adept point to make on that front is sometimes you don't always get a choice what you're involved with. And like it or not, you're in it now.
Or that. That's good too.
Fine.
Where was the body at? And like, where did we find this? We can all loop back to that.
Lucia just like pinches the bridge of her nose. Yeah.
Waiting until now to ask that question.
I'm just looking away.
Reverend Montague found Father Matthews on the church steps early this morning.
If that ain't an affront to God, I don't know what is.
Trust me, there's been plenty of fronts to God in recent weeks, so.
And we should start there. Look at the church and the surrounding area.
Starting there sounds like a good idea. I'll leave you all to it. And she does step back outside, and gaze lingers on Casey for a second. And the second that she's gone, Angela Darcy, who has been standing there
Angela!
The entire time, it's like, so are we done with the body now and the moth and the rose? Can I roll him back up? Because
yeah, go for it. Go. I'm sorry. I am
sort of working here, and she sort of does that. And is there anything else I can help you all with before you head out?
I think I'm good.
Nothing that I can think of. Thank you for your time.
Get some sleep, Angie. You look like you've seen hell.
God, yeah, it doesn't feel far from it of late. The amount of people coming into the clinic, just all hours of the day, keep you up. Something going around. I'd make sure y'all are staying healthy, all right?
Will do.
Will do.
Healthy as a horse.
Wrapping up that little encounter there. Are we heading to the church?
Yippee. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Church time.
I think as we're walking, Sterling tries to bum a cigarette from Casey.
Are you trying to like sneak it from him, or are you?
I think
you
in just... as few words as possible, but it is insistent.
Casey will give and light it for him.
Thanks,
Sterling.
Hmm.
Earlier you said you know what happens when you assume. What happens?
Make an ass of me and you.
Well, I mean, yeah.
Good Lord, save me.
Come on, Rosie. You're having fun.
Well, I guess there's more of a sassy way to say that I don't know nothing. But in general, if you're wondering, I recommend not assuming.
Oh, yeah. I didn't know what happened. You said that something was going to happen, so.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, it doesn't matter.
So stupid.
They're so sweet. I love this.
Head empty, not a single thought behind those eyes.
God. Head empty, just the moth fluttering around in there.
The moth is just flying around and it's hoping to land somewhere, but it hasn't found a perch in like 3 years.
As the four of you approach the church, it's a fairly humble building. It's a small, you know, 19th century Southern church. It's wood, really not even particularly tall compared to the buildings around it, but with a sort of spire and the cross at the top. And you can see a bell up there, but it's quite small. And surprisingly, coming up on late evening on a Friday, there does seem to be a handful of people milling around inside any crime scene that may have been at the stairs of the church has been thoroughly cleaned and seemingly trampled over, and there's a good deal of people moving around inside in the candlelight within the doors.
What's going on there? Can I take like a peek?
Yeah.
Through the door a little bit to see what the hustle and bustle is about?
I mean, it's seems fairly casual almost. There's numerous members of the town, pretty much you recognize everyone, moving around, sharing tea and biscuits. It's very much like a sort of quiet afternoon get-together.
Is this normal?
I think this is fairly normal, perhaps not a regular occurrence, but it's not strange that the more influential members of the town will sort of congregate in the church for these sort of higher social get-togethers. The church and the sort of influence of the families within the church, especially in Umber Hollow, is very prevalent in sort of the image of the people leading the town. So to have sort of a dinner party or an afternoon tea at the church is reasonably common. And you can see Reverend Montague is among the people in there, as is, by the looks of things, quite a number of the extended Garza family moving through the pews.
Mm-hmm. I didn't expect to do this so soon.
Did you expect to do it ever?
I mean, like, yeah. At some point. It was only supposed to be a visit, so, anyway. I think that, Uriel is going to, like, step inside. Kind of, like, bunch their shirt up a little bit, like, when you go back to, like, your house or, like, go back to see, like, family, you're like, well, okay, I have to look a little different. Like, I'm not going to present my way, the way that I present myself out in the world in front of my family. So they, like, kind of pull their hair back in, like, a more neat sort of way. And I think that they're just going to just wait in front of, like, an open area where, like, they are visible clearly. If the family decides to talk to them, they do. And if they don't, then they're just going to keep walking, I guess.
Mm-hmm. I think maybe as the group of you approach the door, Reverend Montague sees you as a group and steps over. And says, oh, well, come on in to our congregation, all of you. It is a pleasure to see you again so soon. Deputy, I haven't seen you around church for a little while. It's nice to see you again.
Well, the trials and tribulations of keeping the town safe sometimes take up a bit more time than I would like.
I'm sure it's quite a responsibility, the authority that you hold.
A lot of people to keep safe, so y'all can keep having your fun congregations. Keep as many people safe as I can.
I'm sure. You know, Ephesians 6, verse 12 tells us that our struggle is not with the flesh and blood.
This is what you saved the Bible as well! This is what quoting it! Hello?
I just took psychic damage. Oh my god.
Oh my god, I think I lost a bone. What the hell?
Flashbacks! Flashbacks!
You can't just pour that out. Like, what? That's what you were researching.
He warned us too. He said.
I warned you.
I first scroll past my page of Bible verses for me to quote. I just grabbed a bunch to be like, I want this character to quote Bible verses at people, but I didn't know any Bible verses.
Biblically accurate Connor.
Biblically accurate.
Biblically accurate Connor. I'm afraid. Biblically accurate Connor isn't real. He can't hurt you.
He is real. He's on the way.
Sorry, that was.
I didn't
that
know
brilliant.
That it would be
that
like in casual conversation.
Oh,
I thought it'd be
Montague.
Like a metaphor.
Absolutely.
No, you're like, nah, man. Happy Tuesday, Corinthians 7.
Yeah, I thought you were going to be like episode 2. Like, or some shit.
Oh my god, that's so funny.
Anyway, that was a really cool moment. Sorry.
Anyway.
That just took us all out.
Ephesians 6, verse 12 tells us that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, and the powers of this dark world and the spiritual forces of evil.
Yeah, put a sock in it, Reverend.
Rosie, I don't recall seeing you around church much recently either. How
yeah, I don't
been?
Have the time. Or the care.
I see.
Uriel kind of bristles at that.
Well, it is nice to see you all here, regardless. Can I help you with something?
I just thought I might be able to speak to my family.
Of course, I'm sure they'll be happy to see you.
Didn't like the way he said that.
What are you doing here? Nothing. You. Nothing. What's it to you?
He sort of just does that stiff kind of bow and then walks back off into the crowd.
I hate that man.
I think there's a handful of, you know, families and people that you do recognize. A lot of them older. There's not actually a lot of young people still left in Umber Hollow. A lot of them sort of in your generations tended to leave town and move out and look for better prospects elsewhere. But some of the people who are around your age, and one of them who recognizes you immediately, Eugene, and drops her plate, which seems to have a sandwich or something on it, creating quite a loud clatter, is your sister, Cleophilas. Cleophilas sort of doesn't say anything, but just looks at you for a moment as if trying to puzzle out if she is actually seeing you, and the dropping of the plate gets the attention of a young man who turns around to reveal himself to be your brother Santiago. Where I will be damned. Look who it is.
It's been a while.
It certainly has. And he sort of, he strides across and goes to like give you a hug and does that sort of like, he gets there and then realizes like, oh, should I be doing this? And he sort of like lingers in the giving you a hug bit.
I think Uriel is gonna go in for the hug. Just like kind of stiffly, awkwardly, just because they're not really used to hugging all that much.
I think he's also quite stiff and awkward about it. And he goes, well, I gotta say, we weren't expecting to see you around when you didn't return for Magdalena's funeral, even. We were, I mean, my dad were getting worried, but did you not hear the letter? Magdalena passed away not long after you left. Mom and Dad sent so many letters to try and reach you about it.
I didn't get a letter.
I'm sorry to drop such dark news the moment you appear on our doorstep, especially in such a place as come inside. I should introduce you something kinda. You remember Hope Simons, right?
Yeah, I remember Hope.
We got married, actually.
No way.
She is Mrs. Hope Garza Simons now. She's somewhere around here, and he sort of gestures, and you can see a bit further to the church, this several months pregnant young woman around the same age as Santiago, sort of mingling and chatting and holding a cup of tea. Yeah, a couple of years ago now.
Oh, we gotta protect these two. Happy newlyweds, one of them... happy newlyweds, one of them's pregnant. Uh-oh. In a horror story. Keep them away from everything remotely dangerous.
There's one thing I know about sex.
As he's sort of giving you this introduction, there is like a rumbling, just heavy footsteps barreling towards you. And as you turn around, it seems impossible that the weight of these footsteps are coming from the tiny toddler that is charging towards Santiago. This tiny little girl who, like, crashes into your brother's legs and yells something that could be along the lines of daddy into his leg, but it's so muffled by the, like, pressing against the fabric. And he just scoops over it. This is, Uriel, this is Maggie, my eldest. Also, Magdalena.
Connor, I'm gonna melt!
I think Uriel's eyes are just, like, so glossy. Like, they have that look like a doll, like, that glossy look that you're like, kind of off-putting that this doll's eyes look wet. And they're just gonna, like, blink down at Maggie and say, and then, like, kind of crouches down and is like, hello, Maggie?
I don't think Maggie says anything to you, but you know when toddlers and babies will just kind of stare?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Maggie is doing that. Maggie is looking back at Uriel with a very similar kind of strange glassy-eyed expression. There is beyond just that kind of usual vacancy in a toddler.
Yeah.
There is that sort of level of, like, looking through you almost with, they're not quite the same brown and green eyes, but the brown does have a hint of blue the longer you look into it, this swirling not too dissimilar to Hope's from what you remember. And just sort of like silently, Maggie sort of like lifts this like chubby little baby hand and just like holds it and does like a little grabby motion towards you. Aww. But it's still just staring at you.
Baby wave!
I was like, as soon as she puts out a hand, like Uriel extends their hand to like shake Maggie's hand and is like, I'm so sorry, I wasn't, forgot my manners. I'm Uriel. And like grabs her little baby hand and like shakes it so very formally.
I think that Santiago sort of like bounces her like up a little higher on his hip to like rest against his chest. He goes, well, she is normally far more talkative than this, which is surprising considering she can probably count as high as the number of words she knows. You have a strange effect, sibling, which I suppose has not changed in the time you've been away.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think at this time, Cleophila is also sort of wanders over to say hi and quite quietly goes, hi. Eugene, it's been a while. It's nice to see you back.
Yeah, this was good. It's good to see you. And like, kind of awkwardly puts out the arms for a hug, kind of like Santiago did.
I think that Cleophila is much more welcoming of the hug, like much more enthusiastic than Santiago was.
I imagine she like grabs them and they like kind of like teeter back a little bit.
She's, well, God, I'm sure that Dad especially would be intrigued to know that you're coming back at such a prosperous time for us at the moment. It's it does seem like all good things coming at once.
Yeah. Do you know where Dad is right now?
He was over there. She sort of like spins around, quietly like scanning the hall, and points out your father, Gabriel, in one of the corners, sort of behind the pews, talking with a man that you don't know and have not seen before. And sort of lingering by their conversation is the Reverend as well, sort of sliding in where he can, and you sort of again can hear him like quoting bits and pieces that you swear are probably scripture just by the,
oh my God,
the cadence of the way his mouth
he's
is moving.
He's so annoying with it. Oh.
He is.
I hate this man.
I love him. He's so fun.
Said in the most dry tone possible. I love him.
But yes, so the man your father's talking to is not someone you recognize from around town. Could very well be, as the sheriff kind of said, new people coming in. Rosie and Casey, you do kind of recognize, not by name, but certainly by face. This is the lawyer that came with the relative of the Whitmires upon the death of the former residents of the estate. He's sort of been around town. Mostly that group do stick to the estate on the outskirts of town, but he does seem to be in quite an animated conversation with Mr. Garza, who you do recognize quite well.
I'd hope so. Interesting.
Those folks don't normally come down to town, do they?
Mm-mm. Strange.
So would I need to go over talk to my, would it be good for the investigation if I were to go over and talk to my father, or are we pretty set as is?
Oh, have you come back over?
Oh wait, was I walking over already?
I just assumed you were all kind of in the
Well, you were talking to your family.
Yeah. It's not a particularly big church. It's a fairly small space, I should say.
I thought we were like kind of giving you your space to do family things.
Yeah.
Oh,
if you're like in, if you're like investigating, like if you're going over there to ask questions about the mystery, then you can like investigate and be like that. Even just having a conversation with someone technically can be investigating mystery. It just decides how much they tell you.
Yeah.
You can also roll to manipulate someone.
You want them to do something they don't want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think Uriel, instead of like going towards their dad, has like kind of retreated a little bit and been like, so I mean, like, how important is it that I go over there right now and talk to him?
Do you think he knows something?
Well, that's a great question. I haven't talked to him, so I don't know. Maybe.
Then, I would say it could wait, if you're not sure.
It's not that I'm not sure, it's just, you know, he looks busy, so I wouldn't want to waste his time or anything like that.
You wouldn't, I don't know the ins and outs of your relationship, but I'm pretty sure he'd probably want to hear from you.
And if I know anything about what conversation with our dear Reverend is like, he probably wants a rescue from that, too.
And, like, under their breath, Uriel's gonna be like, yeah, doubt that. And they're, like, roll their head and, like, walk over.
I think that Mr. Garza Sr. pauses mid animated conversation. You can hear him as you're approaching. Him. No. See, what I don't understand, Mr. Stallworth, is that we signed the papers.
Drama.
The land, I own the land on which that cave system starts, and you're now telling me that I can't go further in? I mean, how much money is it going to take? If I could just speak to young Mr. Graham, I'm sure that we could come to some kind of arrangement. I mean, there is flowing veins of silver in those mines. And the like partway through that sentence sees you approaching in the corner of his eye and just start like, Uriel?
Hello, Father.
I was not expecting to see you here.
Yeah, me neither. The Father Matthews, Father Matthews called me here, so I came running.
I see. That is, he spoke to us about where you might have been. I'm sorry he's not here tonight. I've heard he's touch under the weather at the moment, but he came to talk to us about you. I'm sorry, Mr. Stallworth. Would you excuse me for a moment? And he's like, steps away. I don't think he goes in for a hug, but he definitely gets closer and I think is taller than Eugene and sort of looms over. Do you know why exactly Father Matthews would be asking about the fire?
He didn't tell me. He wasn't asking me about the fire. I didn't say anything about the fire. He was worried about people. He wanted my help. I came to help.
Well, he came to us asking about the fire. He seemed to have a lot of questions, which we have been trying very much to keep quiet, Uriel, especially with the business recently, this new mines, people finding out about the last incident might not work out too kindly. I'm sure you understand what I mean.
I know. I just came to check in and make sure nothing was going wrong. I wasn't gonna do nothing like that.
And he sort of glances around the room and makes eye contact for a moment with someone outside your field of view, but you can probably guess is your mother. Have you met your niece yet?
I have.
See. She likes moths. It's an odd trait for a toddler.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know why Father Matthews wanted to know about starting fires in caves. But if you see him, I think that we have established how much we would prefer to stay quiet.
Yes, sir.
It's good to see you again, Uriel.
Good to see you too.
If you excuse me, I have a rather obnoxious reverend and a very impatient lawyer to get back to.
All right.
He just sort of turns around and moves back to the conversation.
I am so fucking intrigued. I am so intrigued.
Uriel's just going to mosey back over to the group and say, well, I found out that deals are not being kept above board. Or, well, the caves. There's a lot of interest with the caves. And interesting that the legacy of the town founder was missing. And sorry. He went missing. Things are going on in the mines. They don't want them to push further. So if there was a place of intrigue, I think it would be the mines. The caves.
Well then.
At this mention of the caves, it would ring bells for certainly Rosie, and maybe Casey would have picked up on bits and pieces of this. The town of Umber Hollow was built around a gold mine. And once the gold dried up, they started harvesting copper. Most of the mines were owned by the Geiser family, but there has been rumors since the town's founding that there are secret deposits of gold or something else beneath the Whitmire estate.
Hmm. Noted.
Hmm. Hmm. Which mines are we talking about here? The new ones or the old ones?
Well, they're both kind of old, but the ones beneath the legacy, the town founder legacy estate.
Okay, how do you even get down there? They're pretty much abandoned.
Sure, I could find a way in.
Yes, but...
I think perhaps as the group of you do leave the church and start to move out, it has been a little while. As I said, it was late in the evening when you got there, and moving out, a lot of other people are also starting to move back to their homes and trudging across the town center. And there is a noise on the wind. Mm-hmm. That most people don't seem to stop and pay much attention to, and Rosie and Casey may even be somewhat used to it at this point. This sound of the wind carrying something a little more than just the shrill tones of the bluffs. It's a sound that perhaps Sterling has heard, if not become familiar with. Sound of wind moving around a body in the distance. As you walk through the dark.
Thank you everyone for these nice fear ambiance noises.
Yes.
So where are we heading now from the church?
The mansion?
Yeah.
The Whitmire Estate?
Mm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. The Whitmire Estate is very visible from quite a ways away. It is one of the biggest and most impressive buildings. You can clearly tell that even before the discovery of the gold, the Whitmire family was wealthy, certainly wealthy enough to import enough wood to build this house. The fence which borders the land is a good long way from the house itself, and the four of you find yourselves trudging up this dirt path towards the ominous front doors. You can see lights on inside. There are still people moving around. It's maybe getting towards 9:30, 10 in the evening.
Spooky.
Oh, wait, are we knocking or are we breaking in? That's the first question.
Ooh. I'm not opposed to breaking in.
Ooh, I don't know if we have to break. I feel like we can try to knock first.
Yeah, I don't want to get. I'm already. I already feel like I'm on the hot seat.
We can just knock on part the door this. And like start talking to people.
Maybe. Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And just be like, maybe we.
My
mom is
already gonna be upset. I'm missing the night. How do you think she's gonna feel if I'm in the slammer?
Specifically, just Rosie though. Wait. We all get out, but Rosie would get caught and be like scolded by her mom. It would be really unfortunate.
Hey, you've never been scolded by Lillian Deacon.
Lillian Deacon.
No, I'm not. I don't want to mess with her. She seemed like she would fuck me up. Mm-hmm. She feels like she would take out my bones.
Are we knocking or are we breaking in?
I think we've decided we're knocking.
I think we're knocking, yeah.
Oh my god, you sound so sad.
Yeah, I want to cause chaos.
You want to commit grand crimes, go for it.
Grand crimes.
Listen, I already got one cantrip character who's gung-ho about prison breaks and things. Like, I have to have one who's not okay with it.
This is the one that kind of wants to not break into a person's house.
I think that, like, Uriel raises their hand, like starts to, like, grab something and then looks over and remembers that you're a deputy and then like puts their hand away.
Oh my god. I think just looks at the lot of this and is just like, Rose is the only one here with sense, and goes and knocks on the door. Like, is this like the house in front of the mine?
Was long rumored and now seems to be the case that there is a rich deposit of silver in the mines beneath this house. So okay. There's a cave system beneath the house.
Okay. So we don't need the house, we need the mines.
Yes.
Could we not just go to the actual entrance of the mines?
I feel like I've used the terms mines and caves interchangeably. These are like a cave system. This isn't like a mining.
Okay. This is like could we go to entrance, like the cave entrance? Unless it's somehow inside this house.
If you would know where it is. But
is this like like total secrets that there's silver there? Like no one's actually gone down there to do work and stuff?
It was entirely unconfirmed that there was a caving system until mm-hmm. about 6 months ago. So,
and in that 6 months.
And in that 6 months, it has been confirmed that there is silver
mm-hmm.
and that some of the land has been purchased.
Okay. So could we theoretically sneak around the house and find the actual entrance that's somewhere near here?
I was going to say, does it make sense that we're looking for the cave?
I don't think we need to ask the people, can we go into the silver cave?
I was told we're walking up to the house, and I just ran.
I know. I think my brain blinked, and I was like, "Why are we talking to the people? We don't. The entrance isn't in their bathroom. Like, we can just go sneak." Maybe. I mean, it might.
My lack of painting a word picture. There's not like a visible entrance to the caves.
Yeah, like, I meant like, can we like investigate a mystery, search around, and do that?
Well, yeah, but I feel like we're gonna be more likely to find a way into the caves outside the house than inside the mansion.
Yeah. I just meant we don't need to talk to the people in there.
Yeah,
to find it, we can.
Wait, does my dad technically own this house? Was it? Wait,
is this your like nepo baby house?
Is it just the land? Or is this like the house?
All you know from that conversation is that he owns some portion of the caves.
All right, so you go here kind of. Nepo baby privileges.
It doesn't count as breaking in if your dad owns the place.
Oh, wait, yeah. I'll just be like, hey, can you tell me where the entrance is since we own the entrance?
Yeah, we own that half of the entrance so we can go in.
My dad sent me just to, you know, so we could measure the entrance and all that.
Let's back up. Mm-hmm. Let's back away from the mansion. Mm-hmm. Let's back away. Let's pretend we all back up from the mansion. We're all like a little ways away. And then we can probably, in character, be like, I don't think we much need to trouble ourselves with what's inside if we need to go down for what's below. Now, I don't know where the entrance is, but I'm... we could probably divide and conquer and find it, no problem. If we just
What exactly do you think we're gonna find in a cave full of silver that killed something, aside from a knife? Maybe.
I mean, a knife's better than nothing.
You think like some sort of beast is hanging out in the caves? Is that where we're at?
He shrugs a little bit. Who's to say? We need to find something that did it, because it has to be something. We all saw the same body. I'm thinking something's down there. I mean, if you really, truly want to go home, Rosie, I'm not going to hold you to it. Hold you to be here. But I'm going down there. That's my prerogative.
Your prerogative is suicidal.
I'm a deputy. My job.
You think you sound cooler than you are. I hope you know that.
Well, someone's over here being a little bit of a weenie about going into a little cave. Live a little, Rosie. Come on.
Fine. Fine, but like I'm telling you, we ain't gonna find anything down there.
You can. We'll split up, maybe. How about teams of two? You and me. You two seem pretty chummy. How about you two go off and we'll see both directions. See what we can find.
Well, I was.
Is there a problem with that?
Please feel comfortable with the fact that she's going off with him. Please.
Yeah. No, so they good. Are. And then Casey just like raises an eyebrow. We got a problem with that?
I just thought I do. Yeah, I wanted to go with Rosie.
Well, I think you'll be just fine with the partner you brought into town with you.
No, but Rosie and I, there's a lot for us to talk about.
Casey, I think I can speak for myself. Thank you.
Okay, where are you going?
Sterling raises an eyebrow now too.
Yeah, it's like okay, where?
What if I pick Sterling? I want to go with the only one here who I don't have a situation with.
I like how it's like really believe that it's flirting with Rosie and he's not. He's just like this.
He's
like
such a like simp this. And not for Rosie, and it's so funny.
No, he's not. He doesn't give two shits.
It's really funny. I think she knows that too. She's just like, slow your roll every time.
And he just keeps going. It's just his...
Just doing it to mess with Eugene.
Yeah, it's his personality, and he's made like clock that, and he's just like, yeah. I don't know, that's kind of funny. I'm a little bit amused. I like fucking with people a little bit. I'm a little bit of an asshole. In a charming kind of way.
Fine. Uriel, I guess we're going.
All right, Sterling, was it?
Yep.
She'll come with me?
I guess so.
All right.
Go in a hole with the cop? Yeah, sure. Sounds good.
Oh, my God. All right. I'll go by myself. Ugh, shit. Y'all three go, and I'll go by myself. Y'all got such...
Carefully flirts with anything with legs.
You know what? He just starts walking off. Like, I'll just go over to the right. And y'all three can go be hunky-dory in the left. I feel like I keep trying to push the plot along, and we've had three different go-arounds on whether or not we can split up. Go back.
Art and your characters that can see through the fourth wall.
Mm-hmm. And
Art's character.
They all can see through.
You have so much flavor. I love him.
He's so fun.
Sterling's like, my choices are the cop or whatever is going on over here.
That guy.
Whatever tension is happening in this studio.
Yeah.
Well, it might be good to make new friends.
I can't believe I'm saying this, but I would rather go down with the law. Let's go.
I love that. All right, we'll go right. Y'all go left. And we'll pet her off to go investigate.
Who
would like to investigate things first?
What kind of are like your stats and vibes? For Sterling, like, how do you think Sterling would look around? I think we can divide and conquer how we look around, yeah. Like survival versus something else, you know, that kind of vibe.
Yeah, I mean, I've got +2 tough, +1 sharp, and my other stats are 0. That's all
you
I got.
You said +1 sharp?
Yes.
Okay, I'm about the same.
Cool.
Ooh, I think Casey is honestly. Oh. Logistically, how does that work? That was an idea. I don't know if it made sense.
Say it. Say it. Go for it.
I was going to say he's listening, but I don't know how far down it is or how much that makes sense for listening for the drips with his good, good ears.
I think he'd have good, good ears.
Yeah. Like to hear the drip of like water in a cave or the wind.
I was going to say how the wind passes over the entrance of a cave would probably be a significant noise difference.
So like that's what he's looking for. He's using his senses of that variety.
To hear the Minecraft bat noises.
Yeah, I want to listen for the Minecraft bat noises and the creeper.
Casey's got captions turned on in the corner.
Yeah, I do. It's in the corner, guys. There's a wolf that just barked. Let's go. So that's kind of my vibe.
Oh, that's really funny. I think Sterling's initial occupying themselves with putting on their brass knuckles and preparing.
I said that.
I think it takes you a while. This is a big property, and it encompasses a lot of flatlands and a lot of bluffs and a lot of hills and crevices. And between the distant sounds of cattle resting somewhere and the wind blowing around cactuses and swaying in the dried weeds, you do hear movement.
Oh, I thought I had to roll. Hell yeah, let me have this.
No, I think you hear movement. And I think if you were to track that, I would need a roll.
To follow the movement?
But there's something else out here. Yes. Unless I'm misunderstanding how this, that roll works. Which roll were you going to roll?
So when you want to do a thing, you describe the thing you want to do, and then you attach a roll to it.
Yeah,
so
then
I was
you
describing that I'm searching around. So then I was like, oh, I'll investigate. Or I was going to, like, in my brain, roll weird because I want to do something beyond human limitations, which just uses my good, good hearing. That's not human.
That's fair. I mean, if you would
that
like
was
to
my
roll
idea.
Weird.
But if you
like
give me that
weird.
And then now I have to follow the sound, then that's,
I think
I'm switching
the,
it up.
The being able to track the sound in this environment and from such a distance, yeah, you would have to do something to track the sound.
Yeah. Does the sound sound like there's something else here? Or what I'm actually looking for.
There is an echo to it, which is distinct to caves. Like, there is, it's not the sound of wind, it's not the sound of something moving along the ground, it is echoing out from a cave.
Okay. I will do a roll. Okay, that is a 9.
Ooh.
This is a mixed success. I was specifically, since I'm using my good, good ears, rather than investigate a mystery, which I could do, and that'll bring me to a 10, or I could do weird, which is still a full success, but I'm weird about it.
How are you being weird about it, Art?
How are you being weird about it?
I'm listening so good with my big, big ears. My ears aren't that big. I want to do a good, you know, all my senses. Let me get a sniff, let me get a hear. I think if he gets really, really focused on it, maybe he's not paying attention to Sterling, or that they're necessarily around because he's really honed in on, like, where the fuck is that noise? I don't like that sound. And going towards it.
So you're not at all trying to sort of disguise this
I
method
feel like
of
he's,
tracking,
he's not,
sniffing the air, listening to it
like,
from
he's
Sterling.
Not. He's not, like, full-on, like, deep inhaling or anything. I think he's just listening and he's breathing, which is a very pointed thing.
Sterling is like, what the hell?
And he looks wrong. So he's not like outwardly showing a weird, crazy amount of thing. He's just honed in on where he's following and doing so. Like, he looks like he's probably just going in a direction and then stopping for a second and then going in a direction. And like, from any outside perspective, you're like, where the fuck is he going? How do you know what to do? But for him, he's following this sound. He's stopping. He's being quiet. He's listening. He's stalking like a predator.
That's horrifying.
Yeah.
Sterling is probably really annoying because I don't think that they're quiet at all. They're just like stomping through the grass behind them. Being like,
Sterling,
what are you?
Sterling, you're awfully loud.
What do we need to be quiet for?
He just kind of like stops and looks back.
The silence.
I don't have an answer for that.
We are sneaking around a mansion, trying to find an entrance to a silver mine that they don't want anyone to know.
I will say, I think that the two of you are quite a ways away from the mansion by now.
So Sterling just points at the mansion. What?
Okay, listen, logistically, we were trying to go to that mansion for like 5 minutes, and I thought it was closer to the mansion, and that was the problem. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're...
Okay.
Just be quiet.
All right.
And then it goes back to being really weird. Because I said so.
I need you to know, I am imagining like this weird little crab walk, like on the ground, like scuttling between the dude. Like, I know that's not what you described, but for some reason, that was the image in my brain of how they're being weird about it. It's just like creature
scuttling around. That's horrifying.
Behavior.
Horrifying. Thanks, Gunner.
I think with a full success, you do find an entrance to a cave. It's not big. It's certainly not what you would expect of a mine, certainly not one that people like the Garces would be interested in and paying that amount of money for. But there is an entrance to the cave, and you can hear something inside, this slow, cautious shifting of weight. Not quite footsteps, not boots lifting up from the dirt, but something almost sliding through the dirt and scraping at the walls of the cave.
Mm-hmm. When we're far enough away that it is not that loud for me, but I can still hear it, we'll like pull out revolver and just kind of like, it was kind of like a whisper, like pulls it out, loads it, and is like, do you hear it now?
Yeah.
You got a weapon on you?
Oh, absolutely. Already has the brass knuckles on, but also pulls out the sawed-off shotgun.
Oh, hell yeah. That's a nice one. I like that. All right. Easy does it. As sneaky as possible, start walking towards the entrance to get, like, you know, when you, like, lean against the wall and look over, like, that kind of vibe, so you can peek in, like, fully seeing inside.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can't quite tell how far, but you can see the second that you do kind of slip into that entrance or near the entrance, the glow of something deep within the mind that is shimmering and flickering on these huge, wide threads of silver that seem to be tracing their way through the rocks, interspersed at points with the barest flecks of gold within the quartz and stone. It is beautiful looking at it from this perspective, lit from within, radiating and shimmering with this dull, orangey light. And that sort of scraping sound is still echoing louder now, something against the walls of the cave.
Do we have any, like, idea to know that there's multiple entrances? Like, this is probably not the only one. Mm. Do we think that? Or, like, I'm trying to gauge if it's something that we should, like, if we have an inkling that there might be another entrance that the other group could find, if not this one.
I mean, Connor did say this doesn't seem like something... Yeah. That you'd pay a lot of money for.
So they're probably, this probably isn't the main entrance, is what we're getting at. I'm mostly trying to gauge if it is logistically correct for us to go in here under the assumption that, like, assuming they investigate well, they will also be somewhere in here because there's more than one entrance that's accessible, I guess, is my thought process out of character.
Out of character, I'll say, I think, I don't know if there is a way that you would be able to tell. A lot of the mines around here are this sort of, there could be another entrance, or it could just sort of be this smaller cave. It's very hit and miss, and especially with a property as big as this and heading off in different directions, it would be a very large stretch of the same cave, which is not impossible, but it's probably not likely that they're gonna like find a different entrance and meet you in the middle kind of thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then I think we probably shouldn't go in.
Yeah, I was gonna,
because then I don't, like, logistically I don't think we'll meet up with them in character to know that. So, like, probably we know where this is and we can head back to the meeting spot.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll take note of this in our brain palace and then we'll scurry.
Mm-hmm. As you guys start to move away from the entrance to the cave, you can't tell if it is from something you've done or just by chance, but the scratching sound stops and there is a distinct metallic click noise.
Mm.
And now we'll move over to the other two.
I hate that.
To Eugene and Rosie. heading off in a different direction.
What do I have? I think all I can do is investigate a mystery. I don't have many other things. Because this is an immediate danger, so what could go wrong doesn't really fit here.
Mm-hmm. What's what could go wrong, actually?
Whenever you charge into immediate danger without hedging your bets, hold two. You can spend your hold two, inflict one. Yeah, that's for fights.
Yeah, that's not for a fight.
That or just like what we experience if you ran into that cave.
Yeah.
That would count as running into danger.
Yeah, I also have Don't Worry, I'll Check It Out, but that is off by yourself. And that's for marking experience. That's not for anything.
No, that's if you go off on your own, you do that. That's a fun thing you get to do. You just get to get experience for running off on your own.
For anytime, being alone.
In general. Like, you do that, get experience. It's cool.
Yeah, but I'm not doing that right in a second.
Yeah.
I mean, I could roll to investigate, unless you want to.
I have a +1 to sharp, and then there's a thing that I could do, but I don't know if my character would do it as a thing. So I'm going to roll to see if they do it.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Sure.
They don't do it. That makes sense. Anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair. After game, I need you to tell me what it was going to be.
I also would like to know what that was going to be.
But anyway, since you have a +1, you should probably be the one rolling to investigate mystery, because I've got a 0.
I think that they're going to, like, take out the moth that they found in Father Matthew's hand, and they're just going to, like, look at it and, like, dig a little hole out and, like, this is going to get, graphic gross bug things, but yeah. they're going to just take off one of the wings, crumple it into the little hole that they dug out, and, like, cover it with their hand. Ooh. 9. For investigative mystery.
Make success. Make success. Better than a fail.
As you're standing up, and there's this sort of moment of silence where I imagine Rosie is just kind of watching this weird little...
Yeah, she was prepared to, like, walk off and start looking, and he just knelt to the ground and started burying this thing.
Mm-hmm. To be fair, this is so on... Like, when they were a kid, they were a freak, you know? Oh, like, you're like, wow, you did not grow out of this. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I think in this moment of silence, there is this sort of pause, and you can hear something. Mm-hmm. Or perhaps not even hear it, but feel it as you're knelt on the ground, this gentle rumbling, not quite a tremor, but a vibration through the ground. And there's something beneath where you're standing. Some kind of cave system. And you're not far from the house, unless there's a very well-hidden sinkhole, or this is a very long cave system. You can't really see where an entrance would be, but there is definitely space beneath you here for quite a wide stretch. And as you're knelt in the dirt, pondering this and the lack of any cave entrance around, there's this clanking and rustling in the dirt, and suddenly this voice kind of, hello, who is that exactly?
Can I hear this?
Yes. Hello? You can. This is very loud.
She jumps back like 6 feet and she like pulls her gun. Like,
I think as you pull the gun and you turn back, and striding towards you from the house
is
a man probably only like 5-10 years older than you guys, but dressed in like a smoking jacket dressing gown and holding this like big clunky lantern. And the second that he sees you have a gun, oh dear God, who are you? Why are you here? Why are you on my house?
Oh, I thought it was a voice coming from the ground, which was
this is a man running towards you and then suddenly not running towards you. No, yes, he is. And he's just sort of frozen, holding this. It is a miner's lantern, like that kind of spotlight channeled beam of a lantern light coming from the front of this lantern, shining on the two of you as this very startled man with...
Oh, he's startled!
He's...
hold on a minute. Hold on. Like kind of turns to Rosie and is like, hold on, Prim. We don't need all that.
Don't.
Okay. Sorry. I'm not sure we met before. Uriel Garza. I've just kind of been trying to look for the property my father just bought. I'm having a hard time. I don't really know where I'm going. Could you help us, maybe?
There's like a slight relax to this man's shoulders as you said. Oh.
If it helps, she puts away the gun once she realizes it's just a guy.
I see. One of the girls. Sorry, I'm new here. I was under the impression that I had met the extended family. Of course, yes. Sorry, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Graham Widmeyer. I am the owner of the land we're standing on. Sorry, the cave, yes. Sorry, please follow me. It's been a very stressful night, and my groundskeeper has been missing for some time, which is certainly not a good time, considering that last night there was also somebody sneaking around on the property. Please come inside. We can discuss property matters in there. And he sort of like presses the spare hand to his temple and like massages his temple as he starts to turn around and walk back towards the manor house. So as the two, I'm stuck in the voice now. Oh no!
He's being possessed.
Led back to the house. Led back to the house by Graham Whitmire, as he's sort of rambling about the fact that he doesn't know where any of his stuff is.
I'm sorry, you said someone broke it, was snooping around the grounds last night?
Yes, and this is going to sound insane. I could have sworn that the local clergyman was trying to sneak in through my kitchen window. And as you walk past, like, he says kitchen window in a very casual way. There is like a glass wall across the side of the kitchen. Like, you can see the entire kitchen dining room area. It's a very extravagant area. Like, it's like a door, but he's like, the kitchen window. It's,
Which clergyman would that be, by the way?
The elderly gentleman, he's come by before in the past, mostly as an officiant for some of the land deeds. He seems to be quite influential here in the town. Matthews, perhaps? I believe. I could have sworn that he was trying to come inside. My lawyer, Franklin, dealt with whatever it was. He told me it was just something I'd imagined, which, given the stress of this whole situation, perhaps it was.
You didn't see, like, some sort of animal behind him? Like maybe he was running from, I don't know, some kind of cougar or something?
Oh, I don't believe so, but we get all kinds of strange deer and things around these parts the last few months. That is not true. Rosie, you know for a fact, he's like, yeah, we get all kinds of deer, and you're like, no, we don't.
Yeah, yeah, what?
Bro, we're in a desert.
He moves past it casually.
When you say deer, what do you mean by that? You've seen, like, you yourself have seen the deer, or?
Well, I assume they're deer, a bit large, hunched, tall things moving around. I suppose they could be cougar or some kind of cat, but they're much taller. I assumed, I suppose, yes, deer, something large.
And you said there are multiple of them, like a herd of deer?
Rosie has, in her mind, fully decided that this man is insane.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would imagine it would be quite strange for just one of a creature to be around.
But, like, when you saw them, was it like a herd? Because, you know, sometimes a deer wander off from the herd and it's just them by themselves.
No, I only saw them one at a time, usually through the The windows, I feel, up upstairs. That I will admit, it's very dark in the desert at night. I'm not quite used to such open spaces. My family lives on the outskirts of London, normally, until, well, quite a strange turn of events in which I was made the sole benefactor of my uncle's will. Please, come inside. And he sort of leads you into this quite nice and extravagant entryway and sets down the lantern. And you see there are, like, candles and lanterns lit around the place. Brushes some of the dust off his coat. I do apologize for the state of the place. It seems that my predecessor in living here was not exactly the most clean of individuals. And as I expressed, my groundskeeper ran away, it seems.
Who was your groundskeeper, by the way? What, do you know their name?
Oh, yes, that was, this is not him buffering, this is me buffering. He does have a name.
I love the, oh, yes, and then hearing the click of your mouse.
Yeah, so. Click of the mouse, opening a document.
Yes, Winston Klein brought over with me from England. Only a few of us came. It was quite the shame. I'd been working for quite some time back there, but, well, it seems to be the local gossip that he perhaps met a young woman driving cattle. There seems to be quite a few of them passing through at times. Whatever the case may be, three weeks ago now, almost, just sort of stopped showing up for work.
Yeah, just, you know, my father needs to speak with your lawyer, and I was curious myself. How long has your lawyer been your lawyer? Like, was he here the whole time, or traveled with you?
Oh, yes, he's been here the whole time. He's been my family solicitor for 15-odd years now. Brought him over from London specifically. I thought he's the only man that I trust with something as tedious as this whole business. A lot of red tape, I suppose, in actually setting the land. There's some fault now with, and he's sort of just like wandering around, like he's sort of like just moving through the like living room and like waving his hand around, like out of it. You can see on like a counter is a bottle of like absinthe, and this is such a really niche specific thing that I need to get right for my own sanity. When you serve absinthe, there's a thing called an absinthe spoon, which is like a piece of metal that you, with a grate in it, that you put over the glass, and you put a sugar cube on it, and then you tip the absinthe slowly over the cube so it dissolves the sugar. And that clearly was there, and now the absinthe has been drunk.
Mm.
And so he's sort of like moving around and just gesturing and going, oh god, what was he telling me? They bought the land, but the land deed only extends to a certain point, and the entrance that was found recently with highest deposit of silver doesn't count as something. They found knocked through a wall in the basement. It can take forever to fill up.
Is he paying attention to us while he's rambling?
No, not in the slightest.
Okay, can I pull like Uriel over by the arm and be like,
all right, I know what drunk looks like.
No.
Look, and I don't think it's just the alcohol. Look, I don't... We should get out of here. Maybe go looking for ourselves. I don't know. This is a... Deer don't come round these parts. He's saying things.
Brim, I need
don't,
to...
Don't call me Brim.
Rosie. Eli, there's something I really need to tell you. And it might...
Right. Okay, can we get out of the crazy man's house before you do that?
He's not crazy.
The fuck do you mean he's not crazy? Because he's seeing deer and talking like crazy.
There's...
You see that bottle of absinthe? That thing is fucking empty.
I don't think that that's the reason that he's saying this. I think that's an excuse. There's just so much that I don't know how to explain quickly, but When I left, or sent away,
Sent away?
Yeah.
See, I don't know, because I didn't even get a note.
You didn't get my letter?
What letter?
I wrote you a month's worth of letters before I left.
No one gave those to me. Look, that doesn't change anything. Can we please leave this house, please? Like, now?
Okay, yeah.
Because I'm not... This is freaking me out.
Okay. I think they like...
Can we slip out the door?
Out the door? But he mentioned...
Oh, wait, he did mention things. Yeah. Rosie wants to just leave.
Did either of y'all hear him mention a wall in the basement?
That's exactly what I was thinking. I was like, I'm going to send a little moth over to one of the inside windows and just perch there. Just for future things.
As the two of you are starting to move towards the door while Graham is just sort of, I think he's like flopped into like a big chair and is still like just gesturing in the air with his head leaned back.
This poor London man doesn't know what he's doing.
There's a knocking at the front door. Oh, no. Not the sound of someone using the knocker, but something heavy slamming against the wood. Solid, heavy hits. And then there's a pause. And then from outside, you hear the voice of Sheriff Lucia. And she goes, I'm terribly sorry to drop in at such a time as this. There's been a slight emergency out here. If you could let me inside for just a moment.
Oh, you, Connor!
Okay, I think Uriel is going to grab Rosie and, like, pull her back.
Oh, man, because I have to pretend I don't know what the f*** is going on when me as a player know exactly what the f*** is going on!
What are you doing?
I need you to trust me.
Why the f***?
I know that's asking a lot. You cannot invite her inside.
Why not? It's just... What does it matter?
No. Okay, I'm gonna have to say this really quickly, and I'm gonna sound crazy, but there are things out there that are not people. They're not people, and they hurt people. And Lucia is one of those things, and the only way that they're allowed inside an abode is if they're invited inside, and we cannot invite her inside, because she will do harm.
Uriel, you're scaring me.
As long as we don't invite her inside, we're safe.
And as you're having this conversation,
let me guess.
The voice at the door repeats again. I'm sorry, I know it is late, but I saw people moving around. Please, there is a young person here. She's injured. We need somewhere to stay. And a different voice comes from the door. And it's the voice of, it sounds like a little girl.
Oh, no.
Please, I'm cold.
No, don't. It's not real.
And then there
is
more
real
slamming at the door.
Oh my god.
Those heavy knocks. And the same voice just keeps repeating again and again in the same tone. I'm cold.
Oh my god.
I'm not cold.
Oh, damn it.
Rosie,
and after
real.
A little while, the voice starts to get scratchier and scratchier as the knocking turns to clawing. I'm cold. I'm cold. And the scratching at the door is getting louder, and it stops becoming knocks and becomes just something shaking at the door.
I think she was trying to pull away from Uriel to go open the door. But once it starts getting weird, she stops and, like, backs away.
I think. I think that Uriel's gonna cast a hex.
Okay.
Do I have to roll anything for that?
There's a use magic roll. Okay. I forgot now that Art's not here. I'm the one who knows.
I believe it's weird stat is the used magic roll.
Yeah, it's, okay. It's when you use magic, say what you're trying to achieve and how you do the spell, then roll plus weird. On a 10 plus, the magic works without issues. You choose your effect. On a 7 to 9, it works imperfectly. You choose your effect and a glitch. And the keeper will decide what effect the glitch has, and there's a list of glitches.
So I think they're going to, like, grab. They have just, like, a little satchel, and they have, like, a bunch of things in there, and they're going to just grab a handful of just things that are inside there, like herbs and bones and things, and they crush it in their hands, and they, like, look up and they say, "Forgive me." And just a swell of moths are going to aggregate, fly out of the windows, and start to rain down like holy fire into this person.
What the Jesus fuck? Christ.
I rolled a 10.
Yeah! You do it! No glitches!
And suddenly, as you're doing this, and these moths that seem to emerge from nowhere, shimmering and shuffling and pressing out from inside the floorboards and out from underneath the couch that Graham seems to have fallen on, who you look over and his hands are pressed to his ears, just trying to dull the sound of whatever is outside, screaming to get in this rasping, ghoulish imitation of a child's voice. And then it turns to this howling, animal-like scream as the moths rain down and encircle this thing, and you can hear it slamming its full body weight against the door. And then everything stops. In Revelations 8, verse 7, the angel sounded, and there followed a hail of fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth. And a third part of the trees was burned up, and all of the grass was burnt up with it. And that is where we will end.
You motherfucker.
That was so good. Did you have that?
You had that at the ready?
I had that at the ready.
It was like rain down holy fire, and you had the perfect verse for it.
The second you said that, I knew exactly where the verse was in my notes.
God damn.
Tee-hee.
And I hope you guys have enjoyed the first part of 6 Feet Under, Halloween special for cantrips.
Holy shit.
Shit, I feel bad for Rosie. That's potentially the worst fucking way to find out that this is happening.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah.
Scary as shit.
Thank you so much, everyone, for listening to Cantrip's first little foray into Monster of the
Week.
Woo! I don't know if you guys can tell, but
I'm such a Monster of the Week bitch.
I love Monster of the Week. Writing horror is like my favorite thing to write, and I like
You're
it
very
a lot.
Good at
and
it.
Thank you. I've been sitting. And you guys know that that encounter at the door was the first ever concept piece for this.
It worked. I was literally my skin crawling. It was insane.
That was free. Yeah, I was just like,
glad. I've been cooking on this session for a long time in the background. If you would like to listen to part two potentially earlier, then you can follow us on Patreon. The Cantrip Patreon comes with a whole bunch of really cool bonus content, including early access to episodes, a bunch of short stories and maps and things like that, as well as blooper episodes and extended cuts of scenes and things like that, especially from some of our specials where we have a bunch of extra content. You can leave a comment on YouTube or Spotify, which we do read, and we kick our little feet about them every time. We check him sometimes. But yes, remember to like and subscribe or follow us, depending on where you're listening. I think that a fun thing to comment on part one is who you think is the creature or the murderer, perhaps, of Father Matthews. Who do you think is responsible?
Well, I think it would be a fun thing to comment. Strong idea right now.
If you would like to discuss theories or anything like that, we have both a Discord server linked in the show notes below and a Tumblr tag, which a bunch of us cast are always around both milling about. You can also find us on various social medias, including Instagram and TikTok. We're working on getting some more stuff on there at Cantripped or Cantripped Pod, I believe, is our Instagram handle. Yeah. Is there anything that I'm forgetting?
Tell your friends about the cool Halloween podcast.
Yeah, tell your friends. If you have friends who like spooky things.
I thought you were going
to... Tell them to come over here.
Where did my brain go? Yeah, if you have friends, you loser.
One-shots are a good spot to jump in.
Just say, also, if you have a situationship. If you have a situationship that you want to drop in hints.
If you have a vaguely spooky situationship that you think would enjoy this podcast, let them know.
Hell yeah.
If you have friends who are fans of Western things, horror things,
Connor's
spooky things in general, my things, just give this episode a go. If you like this horror-themed episode, we do have another horror one-shot called Redshift Station, the complete opposite.
Yeah, let's go.
It is a sci-fi horror inspired by things like Alien and Among Us and a bunch of fun, funky things like that that I think people will really enjoy. Yeah, I think that is about everything.
Guys, I just opened Twitter. They put out the FNAF 2 movie release date.
What? When is it?
Holy
when is it?
December 5th, 2025, baby!
December 5th.
Oh, hell no.
There you go. There's a good timestamp for when this episode was recorded.
When this episode was recorded. But speaking of timestamps, so when this episode is recorded, all things planned, this should drop either just before or just on Halloween. And I hope that everyone has a very happy Halloween, a wonderful Samhain, or if you're in the Southern Hemisphere like me, I hope you have a very happy Estada as well.
You fucking freaks who have a warm Halloween.
I hope no creatures come knocking on your door.
I hope that no weird creatures. Yeah. Hopefully no weird creatures come banging at your door in the middle of the night to get at the creepy wall in your basement. I think that is everything from us here in Umber Hollow. Thank you for digging 6 feet deep.